Welcome to the fascinating world of human microbiota. Imagine trillions of organisms, each with unique roles, living in a harmony within your body. From your skin to your gut, the human microbiota is a bustling ecosystem of bacteria, viruses, fungi, and more, each contributing to your health in surprising ways. These microbes don't just live on you, they work with you, aiding in digestion, protecting against harmful invaders, and even influencing your immune system. Today we will begin our journey into a hidden world, exploring how these tiny companions shape your health, impact disease, and reveal the incredible complexity of the human body. You might also hear microbiota referred as microflora, so keep both terms in mind as we go forward. So, what do we mean by normal human microbiota? This phrase refers to the community of microorganisms that live on various parts of the human body. On our skin, in our saliva and oral cavities, within the conjunctiva of our eye, and throughout our gastrointestinal tract. You might have heard the term germs, which often carries a negative connotation. However, our microorganisms are essential for maintaining our health. In fact, only a very small percentage actually cause disease. When we talk about bacteria in human microbiota, we are not just discussing germs in the sense of disease, but rather organisms that contribute significantly to health and well-being. Microorganisms that we encounter include bacteria, fungi, algae, protozoa, and viruses. And as scientists learn more about them, it is clear that each type plays a unique role in your health. Today, though, our focus will be on bacteria, the most widely studied organism in the human microbiota. The study of bacteria is known as bacteriology. To date, scientists have studied only about 1% of all microbial species on Earth. For a long time, it was commonly stated that bacterial cells in human body outnumber human cells by a ratio of 10 to 1. However, more recent studies suggest that the number are much closer. According to updated estimates, the human body has about 30 trillion human cells. The bacterial cells count in the body is estimated to be around 39 trillion. This brings the ratio closer to 1 to 1, or slightly more bacterial cells than human cells, depending on individual differences in size, diet and microbiota composition. The largest concentration of bacterial cells in the gut, particularly in the colon, where they play essential roles in digestion, immunity, and overall health. We can classify bacteria by their shape and cell arrangement. There are cocci. The word cocci, singular coccus, is derived from Greek word kokos, which means berry or seed. This etymology reflects the round, spherical shape of bacteria classified as cocci, which resemble small berries when observed under a microscope. There are bacilli, which are rod-shaped. The word bacilli, singular bacillus, comes from the Latin word baculus, which is diminutive from the baculum, meaning stick or rod. This reflects a rod-shaped appearance of bacteria classified as bacilli when viewed under a microscope. There are spirochetes, which are spiral-shaped. The word spirochete, singular spirochete, is derived from a combination of Greek and Latin roots, reflecting the helical spiral-shaped structure of this bacteria. And vibrio bacteria have a curved, comma-like shape. Bacteria are also classified based on arrangements of their cells after division. There are diplococci, which are arranged in pairs, with two spherical cells joined together. Streptococci, which are arranged in chains with multiple cells linked together in a linear sequence. Staphylococci, which are arranged in grape-like clusters with multiple spherical cells grouped together. And streptobacilli, which are arranged in chains with rod-shaped cells linked end-to-end in a linear formation. These shapes and arrangements often help us identify specific bacterial types. Now let's get into our different areas of human body where bacteria are found and their roles. Starting with the eyes, the conjunctiva, the membrane covering the white part of the eye, harbors harmless strains of Staphylococcus epidermis and Streptococcus that keep pathogens in check. The eye's tear-film and immune defense typically keep the bacterial population in check, preventing infection. However, poor hygiene, contact lens use, and other factors can disrupt this balance, leading to eye infections. Moving to the ears, we find that the outer ear contains over 200 bacterial species, while the inner ear remains sterile or free of microorganisms. Some of the bacteria present in and around the ear can play a protective role, particularly by competing with potential pathogens for resources and space. This phenomenon is part of the natural microbial balance, which helps remain a healthy environment in the ear and may indirectly protect the inner ear from infections. In the nose, at least 20% of people carry a virulent strain of Staphylococcus aureus, while everyone else harbors less harmful strains of Staphylococcus, Neisseria, and Corine bacteria, which help prevent colonization by pathogen like Streptococcus pneumoniae. Let's take a closer look at the human mouth, which hosts a wide variety of microorganisms, primarily bacteria. You may have heard of halitosis or bad breath, a condition largely caused by microbial metabolism. In fact, 85 to 90% of bad breath cases originate in the mouth, not in the stomach, as some people think. Only in severe illness might the odor stem from the stomach. Bad breath often originates from bacterial digestion of protein. Many of us enjoy foods like meat, steaks, sausages, and various cuts, which include not only soft skeletal muscles, but also tougher connective tissue like tendons, which connect muscles to bones. When pieces of this food, often tendons, get lodged between teeth, they provide a rich food source for bacteria. If left overnight, bacteria will break down these proteins and release unpleasant-smelling compounds. For instance, hydrogen sulfide produces a rotten egg odor. Methylmercaptan indolens scuttle contribute to fecal smells. Cadaverin and putrescine are responsible for smell of decaying flesh. And isovaleric acid is associated with the odor of sweaty feet. And yes, all these odors combine into a distinctive bouquet that emanates from our mouths. The mix of volatile compounds like sulfur-containing gases, indole, and even isovaleric acid creates a characteristic smell associated with bad breath, especially when bacteria thrives in areas with trapped food particles or plaque buildup. Interestingly, indole, known for its strong odor, often associated with feces, sometimes used in perfume in very small amounts, where it can add a pleasant depth to fragrances. Though in higher concentration, the scent becomes overwhelming. As you see, the bacteria in our mouth release a variety of chemicals which can make human breath noticeably unpleasant at times. Morning breath is largely due to the volatile nature of the products of bacterial metabolism in a dry mouth. When we sleep, our mouth becomes dry and bacteria metabolize proteins, producing volatile odorous compounds that we just covered into the air. Upon drinking water in the morning, the mouth is rehydrated, which reduces the volatility of these compounds. The increased moisture makes it harder for these gases to disperse, thereby lessening the strength of the smell. In essence, water helps create a more humid environment in the mouth, minimizing the release of odorous compounds into the air and making morning breath less noticeable. The best way to prevent bad breath is through good oral hygiene. Today we have many options for maintaining it, including various types of toothpaste and mouthwashes. And don't forget flossing. It is essential for removing food particles that can harbor bacteria, helping to prevent both bad breath and tooth decay. While complete elimination of oral bacteria is impossible and not desirable as some bacteria prevent fungal infection, regular brushing and flossing is significantly reduced the population of odor-causing bacteria. Even with mouthwash and brushing, you will never entirely remove all bacteria. But it's okay, they play an essential role in oral health. Gingivitis is an inflammation of the gums or gingiva, is typically caused by plaque buildup. Plaque is a sticky bacterial film that constantly forms on teeth. When bacteria in plaque produce acids after eating or drinking, these acids can erode tooth enamel. and lead to both cavities and gingivitis. Dental cavities, also known as tooth decay or caries, are permanently damaged areas in the hard surface of the teeth that develop into tiny holes. They occur when bacteria in the mouth produce acids that erode tooth enamel, often due to sugary foods, poor oral hygiene, or lack of fluoride. Untreated cavities can lead to pain, infection, and even tooth loss. Cavities can affect people of all ages. As I said earlier, consistent oral hygiene practices help keep these conditions at bay, promoting a healthier mouth overall. Acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis is a severe gum infection characterized by painful bleeding gums, ulcerations, and tissue death, necrosis. Commonly called trench mouth, it often results from poor oral hygiene, smoking, or weakened immunity. Immediate treatment is essential to prevent further tissue damage and alleviate pain. On the skin, which is generally dry and acidic with high salinity, most bacteria struggle to survive. However, certain areas, the armpits and groin, offer a more hospitable environment where bacteria break down sweat components and produce odors. This explains why exercise often calls for a good shower and a change of clothes to keep bacterial growth in check. The warm, humid environment of the armpits and groin is home to about 12 trillion skin bacteria. Sweat ducts release urea, proteins, salts, and lactic acid, which is initially odorless. Corine bacterium species break down these compounds, producing 3-methyl-2-hexanoic acid, which is often described as a pungent or characteristic of body odor. Interestingly, the stomach was once thought too acidic to support any bacteria, but in early 1980s, researchers Barry Marshall and Robin Warren identified Helicobacter pylori in stomach biopsies, leading to new insights into ulcers and gastritis. The bacteria's spiral shape allows it to burrow into the stomach lining, causing inflammation. For their discovery, they were awarded the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2005. So while stress and spicy food were once believed to cause ulcers, it is now known that bacterial infections or certain medications are the real culprits. A stomach or gastric ulcer is the lesions in the stomach lining. Now we know that majority of these ulcers result from an infection with the bacterium H. pylori or the use of anti-inflammatory drugs, rather than stress or unhealthy diet as previously believed. Treatment typically involves antibiotics and medications that reduce stomach acid. The small intestine hosts a diverse population of bacteria, including bacteroids, streptococci, bifidobacteria, and clostridia. A 2002 study revealed that one of the species, bacteroids Tetiaeta micron, plays a crucial role in signaling to the proper development of blood vessels in the intestines after birth. The intestines, particularly the large intestines, are home to trillions of bacteria. This bacteria contributes to digestion, produce vitamin K for blood clotting, and communicate with our immune system. They also take resistance and crowd out harmful bacteria that could otherwise cause infections or even colitis. In fact, treatments like fecal microbiota transplants are now saving lives by restoring the balance of bacteria in the gut. The majority of the urethra is typically sterile, meaning it does not harbor any bacteria or other microorganisms under normal conditions. This sterility is essential to prevent infections from ascending into the bladder, causing cystitis, or further into the kidney, causing polyonephritis. The urethra is normally sterile except for the half inch near the exit. The sterility of the urethra plays a crucial role in preventing urinary tract infections. The vagina stays slightly acidic, with pH around 4 to 5, thanks to the work of lactobacillus bacteria. These helpful microbes produce lactic acid, which keeps harmful bacteria in check. If something disrupts the lactobacillus population, the pH can rise, creating a perfect condition for candida fungus to grow and potentially cause a yeast infection. Various species of moisture-loving bacteria flourish between the toes. Some ferment acids, producing the smell of sweaty feet. Sterile areas include liver, pancreas, gallbladder, and blood. Any bacteria found in these areas usually indicates infection, such as hepatitis when viruses infect the liver, or sepsis if bacteria multiply in the bloodstream. As we conclude the exploration of the human microbiota, I hope you have gained a deeper appreciation for the complex roles bacteria play. We have primarily focused on bacterial inhabitants in various body sites, their benefits and their interactions with other organisms. While we still have much to learn, it is clear that bacteria are more than just germs. They are essential partners in maintaining our health. Thank you for joining this lecture. Have a great day! Thank you.